Nice to see you all.
Yeah, good to see you.
Nice to have this subject for today. So important.
Nice to see you.
And even more on the anniversary of the 8th of March.
Yes, it's a big day.
150 years from her birth, but at the same time, just one day before the peak day of the 8th of March. We had our marching yesterday.
Yes.
For tomorrow.
Did you?
We took
How did
the
it go?
Saturday. Okay, about 2,000 to 2,500 people under the coronavirus and the restrictions. It was a great success.
That's brilliant.
And
yeah.
The media did not present almost anything.
So where are you from?
From Cyprus. But we have broken these restrictions by a huge demonstration which took place on the 20th of February. 10,000 people, not really the parties in it, but organizations, movements, basically from the youth starting, but we also participated in our age. And it was say until here and no further.
What was that one for?
For everything, for the corruption, for the scandals, for the non-proceeding of for the solution of the Cyprus problem, for the oppression, for the economy, everything.
All right, comrades. Well, as you know, we're celebrating today not only International Women's Day, but also the 150th birthday of Rosa Luxemburg. Rosa Luxemburg's life represents a perfect combination of theory and practice. She wrote classic works of Marxist literature, and she threw herself body and soul into the struggles of working people. She was a gigantic presence in the labor movements of Poland, Russia, and Germany. Like so many great revolutionaries in her lifetime, Rosa Luxemburg was reviled, slandered, exiled, jailed, and pretty soon murdered. But also, like so many great revolutionaries, after her death, attempts were made to reduce her to a harmless icon, her role grossly distorted and misrepresented as a supposed enemy of the Russian Revolution. The fact is that, of course, she questioned aspects of Marx's economic theories. She raised some practical objections to aspects of the Bolsheviks' practice, but these were products of that fertile, creative spirit, which is common to all genuine revolutionaries. I'd like to just quote one beautiful couple of sentences from Rosa. She said, "Marxism does not consist of a dozen persons who have granted each other the right to be the experts, before whom the masses are supposed to prostrate themselves in blind obedience like loyal followers of the true faith of Islam. Marxism is a revolutionary outlook on the world that must always strive towards new knowledge and new discoveries. Its living force is best preserved in the intellectual clash of self-criticism and in the midst of history's thunder and lightning." Now, of course, no one witnessed more of history's thunder and lightning than Rosa Luxemburg in her lifetime. But that quote, I think, sums up perfectly our outlook, the outlook of the Workers' International Network, in sharp contrast to all those sectarian cliques, each of which masquerades as the exclusive repository of a true faith. We too have no popes, no gurus. We base ourselves on the free and comradely clash of ideas in reaching collectively a clearer, sharper, higher understanding of the world around us. Now, I want to introduce two outstanding speakers that we have. Before I do, I just want to put in a little plug. I want to advertise a great film which I came across recently, quite by chance, on Netflix. It's a German biopic made in 1986 called simply Rosa Luxemburg. I really appeal to everybody, I urge everyone to watch it. It's a brilliant depiction of the debates ranging within the German social democracy before the First World War. We come face to face with figures from history like Babel, Kautsky, Bernstein, Clara Tetkin, Leo Jurgiches, and we witness the subsequent splits and betrayals, and we follow the heroic path of Rosa Luxemburg, ending in her grisly murder alongside her ally Karl Liebknecht. Our speakers today are Felicity Dowling, herself an exemplary revolutionary fighter, one of the famous Liverpool councillors that for 5 years in the 1980s defied the Thatcher government in defence of the rights and living standards of the people of Liverpool. Today she is Secretary, National Secretary of Left Unity and a militant campaigner in defence of women's rights and of the National Health Service. Our other speaker today is Thomas Berger, who has been a dedicated socialist activist within the German labour movement for decades now. He is a lawyer who exclusively represents employees, works councils and unions, and advises and represents many works councils. He's an expert in questions of the German works constitution and its reform, and he's a member of the group of socialist trade unionists. I think both of these comrades are absolutely amply qualified to speak on this subject. I don't know which of you wants to speak first. We didn't work that out. Would either of you wish to volunteer? Thomas, right, thank you. Thomas Berger.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Felicity, is it okay that I speak first? Yeah, thanks a lot. Yes, let us remember and celebrate Rosa Luxemburg. Today we remember and celebrate an outstanding woman and fighter for global democracy and socialism. 150 years ago, on March 5th, 1871, Rosa Luxemburg was born in the small town of Samosz, southeastern Poland, part of Tsarist Russia. Along with Lenin and Trotsky, she was one of the most important leaders of the socialist movement of the 20th century. She was murdered by right-wing Freikorps, paramilitary troops, organizational predecessors of the fascists in Germany. In today's conditions of deep crisis, Luxembourg's theoretical writings and articles and her ongoing struggle within the labor movement contain important lessons. For us, however, Rosa is also an outstanding and important role model for her view of the world, of people, nature, and animals, and for her courageous personal commitment, which in the end cost her life. It is no accident that we are seeing a new reading of her books, mainly among younger people, especially in Latin America, Chile, Argentina, and Brazil, but also among eco-socialists and animal rights activists around the world. You can see the Rosa Luxemburg's popularity is increasing. Every year, a demonstration for her commemoration takes place in Berlin with 10,000 participants and another 50,000 to 100,000 people who visit her and Karl Liebknecht's grave in the Zentralfriedhof Friedrichsfelde and place flowers here, there. The personality of Rosa Luxemburg. Rosa Luxemburg had an excellent intellect and exceptional theoretical and rhetorical skills. She was very educated, spoke German, Polish, Russian, and French fluently, and understood other languages. She was capable of tremendous passion and possessed a fascinating personality who, then as now, attracted workers and intellectuals alike. She loved literature and was familiar with it from childhood. At the age of 6, she began writing for a children's newspaper, soon after began translating Russian poetry into Polish and wrote her own. She could recite many, including poems by the Polish national poet Adam Mickiewicz or German poets such as Goethe and Moravec. Her love for nature and animals is clearly evident in her letters from prisons. She first studied zoology, biological philosophy and mathematics before switching to law and economics. At the age of 26, she received her doctorate with summa cum laude. Rosa combined her cultural, scientific, and intellectual potential with impressive personal courage, willingness to make sacrifices, and fighting spirit. Rosa Luxemburg joined the band group Second Proletariat at the age of 16 without hiding it at home or at school. She read the writings of Karl Marx for the first time. She passed the Abitur as the best in the class and with the highest grade, excellent. The school administration refused the gold medal to which she was entitled because of an opposition to the authorities. In December 88, she fled from the Tsar's police, which had discovered her membership, first from Warsaw and finally to Switzerland. Her persistence in defending and applying socialist and democratic principles was remarkable. She was an independent spirit in the best sense of the word, with her autonomy based on lively intelligence and scientific method. Because of these virtues, she was able to develop and defend new ideas without fear and with disarming openness. This often resulted in anger and quarrel with other authorities and personalities for Rosa. The disputes with Bernstein, Bebel, Kautsky, but also the differences of opinion with Lenin and Trotsky, each led to enormous enrichment of the teachings of scientific socialism. The greatest of her strengths was probably Rosa's enormous trust in the labor movement and the further development of it in its arguments and struggles. Rosa saw the creativity and learning ability of the labor movement. For example, the spontaneous development of the mass strikes as a weapon and the formation of workers' councils as a result of the Russian Revolution of 1905. These experiences led her to the deep conviction that the labor movement would be able to carry out its historical task to meet. Rosa followed the movements of her time very closely, even under the most adverse conditions. In these struggles, she discovered the development potentials necessary for the goal of socialist democracy. She tried to make the respective experience and insights practically fruitful for the international movement and fought for this with resolutions and lectures at party and trade union congresses, articles in newspapers and speeches on the street and at workers' meetings. At the same time, however, Rosa was also very realistic about the dangers and risks posed by the destructive forces of capitalism, nationalism, imperialism, and war. Unfortunately, she did not protect herself and other leading comrades enough from these dangers because she refused to leave Berlin and thus exposed herself to her murderers. Summary of her political life. From 1887, she worked in the Polish, from 98, also in the German social democracy. There, she fought against nationalism, opportunism, and revisionism from the start. She advocated mass strikes as a means of change of society and to prevent war. Immediately after the beginning of the First World War in 1914, she founded the Gruppe Internationale, from which the Spartakusbund emerged. As a political prisoner, she led this through political writings in which she analyzed and condemned the SPD's Burgfrieden, its truce policy with the ruling class, together with Karl Liebknecht. Rosa Luxemburg supported the October Revolution, but at the same time criticized the policy of Lenin and the Bolsheviks regarding the agrarian and the national question and on questions of socialist democracy. During the November Revolution, she tried to influence current affairs as editor-in-chief of the newspaper Die Rote Fahne, the Red Flag, in Berlin. As the author of the Spartakusbund program on December the 14th, 1980, she called for a council republic, the disempowerment of the military and armament of the people. At the beginning of 1919, she co-founded the Communist Party of Germany, which accepted her program but refused, against her opinion, to participate in the upcoming parliamentary elections. After the subsequent Spartacus uprising was suppressed, she and Karl Liebknecht were murdered by members of the Guard Cavalry Rifle Division and paramilitary group. This murderous act was supported by the SPD leaders Gustav Noske, backed by Friedrich Ebert, also SPD leader. These murders have deepened the split between the SPD and the KPD. Now of the third part, and called it What Remains. And Roger, you can stop me at any time. As I worked it out, I found more and more points which has to be made, what remains from Rosa Luxemburg. So I will concentrate only on two, three or four points and then leave the place and the time for Felicity and the other comrades and participants. What remains? First of all, I think Rosa's struggle for a majority in the workers' organizations and the workers' movement. Rosa Luxemburg firmly believed that only the overthrow of capitalism by the working class could solve the great problems of humanity, such as hunger, poverty, exploitation, all kinds of oppression and war. For this, she led a fight to win the majority inside the workers' parties and the unions for this mission. She saw it as her task to impart knowledge and understanding, to sharpen the consciousness of the workers, and to awaken their courage to fight by showing the necessary political tasks resulting from the economic, social, and political events. This made Rosa incredibly popular with workers. When she spoke, the events were well attended and her lectures were often interrupted and ended also by frenetic applause. That's also seen in the film Roger mentioned quite clearly. To take up the struggle for a majority, she moved after finishing studies to Germany because the German Social Democratic Party, the SPD, was seen as a flagship of the second, the Socialist International. Already in her speech at the Party Congress in 1898, she made it clear where she stood politically. Quote, "On the left wing, where you fight with the enemy, and not on the right, where you want to compromise with the enemy," end quote. What remains, secondly, Rosa's internationalism. It's seen in, especially in Rosa's struggle against the coming First World War. Rosa Luxemburg warned at an early stage of a coming war between the major European powers. She attacked German militarism and imperialism more and more and tried to force the SPD to talk an energetic countercourse. She called on the SPD to prepare for a general strike against the war in order to practice, quote, international solidarity of the working class, end quote. At the Congress of the Second International in Stuttgart in 1907, she successfully introduced a resolution that provided for joint action by all European workers' parties against the war. In 1912, as a representative of the SPD, she traveled to European Socialist Congresses, including the one in Paris, where she and Jean Jaurès made the European Workers' Parties a solemn commitment to call a general strike when war broke out. When the Balkan War almost triggered a world war in 1913, she organized demonstrations against the war. In speeches, she called on a crowd of hundreds of thousands to refuse military service and to refuse to obey orders. Quote, "If we are expected to use the murderous weapons against our French or other foreign brothers, we declare, no, we will not do that," end quote. As a result, she was sentenced to a total of 14 months in prison. Her speech before the criminal chamber was later published under the title Militarism, War, and the Working Class. The second thing was then her resistance against nationalism, imperialism, and war when the war started, together with Karl Liebknecht. On August 4th, 1914, the SPD deputies in parliament voted unanimously for war credits and thus made mobilization and war possible. The German trade union leadership had already announced on August 2nd that they would practice a strike and wage waiver for the entire duration of the impending war. Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht led the minority that resisted the wave of chauvinism, first organized as Truppe Internationale, and later published the Gruppe Internationale, which produced the paper The International, and later called Spartakusgruppe. Luxembourg's first lead article in the International stated, quote, on August 4th, 1914, German social democracy abdicated politically, and at the same time, the Socialist International collapsed, end quote. Rosa Luxemburg analyzed the failure of the SPD, the Second International, and almost all of their national parties in her essay, The Crisis of Social Democracy, called Junius pamphlet, published in June 1916 under the pseudonym Junius. She argued that the war on war slogan should become the cornerstone of working class politics. She explained that the Second International had imploded because it failed to achieve a common tactic and action by the proletariat in all countries. From then on, the main goal of the proletariat should be fighting imperialism and preventing wars and peace as in war. She described and explained it in more detail, but because of time, I will not go into the details. There are two examples how she struggled for internationalism in a very practical and also existential sense. What remains on the third place is Rosa Luxemburg's trust in the workers' movement. That is seen in the revolution of 1905 in Russia, where the Russian Revolution broke out in 1905, Luxemburg went to Polish Warsaw, part of Tsarist Russia. Rosa participated active in the revolution, was arrested, and could avoid a lengthy prison sentence and possible death thanks to the intervention of the SPD. She experienced the emergence of new forms of struggles and workers' representation. The political mass strikes and workers' councils elected by workers themselves. Who was the inventor and the developer? Her answer, the spontaneous movement of the workers itself. Rosa wrote a book to analyze and generalize the Russian experience called The Mass Strikes, the Political Party and the Trade Union. It was published in 1906. She explains how these mass strikes developed spontaneously and stressed the key role of the protest, mostly unorganized layers of the proletariat. These events deepened her position that the masses in struggle were the true protagonists and developers of history. Rosa saw the mass strikes as, quote, the living pulse beat of the revolution, end quote, and at the same time, its most powerful driving wheel, the true mode of movement of the proletarian mass, the phenomenal form of the proletarian struggle in the revolution. For Rosa, the mass strike was not a single isolated tactical action, but a preparation, a school for the maturing of the working class, precondition for a successful revolution. When Rosa propagated the political mass strike in Germany, the union leaders reacted with harsh rejection. Their position crystallized in the motto of the Cologne Union Congress in 1905, quote, "The unions need peace first and foremost," end quote. In order to maintain this peace, they forbade Luxembourg to speak at trade union events. Luxembourg was often condemned for their theory of spontaneity and her allegedly underestimation of building a revolutionary organization. Trotsky defended Rosa Luxemburg and wrote that Luxembourg's counterposition of the spontaneity of mass actions to the conservative policy of the SPD had a thoroughly revolutionary and progressive character. Trotsky continued, quote, "At a much earlier date than Lenin, Rosa Luxemburg grasped the retarding character of the ossified party and trade union apparatus and began a struggle against it. Rosa herself never confined herself to the mere theory of spontaneity, but exerted herself to educate the revolutionary wing of the proletariat in advance and to bring it together organizationally as far as possible." And the last point which I want to make is what remains Rosa's struggle for socialist democracy. It's seen first and foremost in the November Revolution in Germany in 1918 and in the founding of the Communist Party of Germany. Amid the revolutionary struggles, the Communist Party of Germany, KPD, in Berlin was founded at the end of 1918. Rosa Luxemburg wrote the party program and presented it to the delegates. It explicitly formulated the goal of overthrowing bourgeois class rule. When Luxemburg suspected that Ebert would use military units, that's the SPD government, would use military units against Berlin workers, she demanded all power for the councils. Election of workers' councils in all Germany by the entire adult working population of both sexes. The right of workers and soldiers to recall their representatives at any time. The disarming of the police force and of all officers and non-proletarian soldiers, and the arming of the people. A few days later, after this article was published, the Reichsräte Congress, that is the Nationwide Workers and Soldiers Congress, met from the 16th to 20th December of 1918. Only 10 Spartacists, that are the supporters of Rosa Luxemburg, were represented. Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht were not given the right to speak at this all German Workers' Council meeting. A majority vote voted for a parliamentary election to the Weimar National Assembly on January 19th, 1919, and the self-dissolution of the Workers' Council. A control commission was supposed to supervise the military. A socialization commission was supposed to begin the expropriation of large-scale industries that were so important to the war effort. The council power abolished itself. The KPD decided on the program of the Spartakusbund formulated by Rosa Luxemburg at the beginning of December 1918. Quote, the Spartakusbund will never take over government power other than through the clear and unambitious will of the great majority of the proletarian masses in Germany. Never other than by virtue of their conscious consent to the views, goals, and methods of struggle of the Spartakusbund, end quote. The second point on this is on the question of her understanding of socialist democracy and dictatorship of the proletariat, her book on the Russian Revolution. In her book on the Russian Revolution, Luxemburg supported enthusiastically the October Revolution by the Bolsheviks. She unconditionally defended the Bolsheviks against the counter-revolution and right-wing or centrist social democratic attacks. She criticized the Bolsheviks, namely Lenin and Trotsky clearly, but also with solidar attitude. She noted that what she saw as mistakes arose out of the difficult conditions the Bolsheviks confronted due to the betrayal by the Second International and German social democracy. Here's not the place to go into detail about the historical debate between Rosa and the Bolsheviks. Looking at the text through the eyes of today with the perspective of tomorrow, the text is one of utter importance. Rosa Luxemburg is famous for her words that there cannot be democracy without socialism, and there cannot be socialism without democracy. Socialist democracy meant for Rosa the most active, unlimited participation of the mass of the people, unlimited democracy. Luxemburg was firmly convinced that socialism by its nature cannot be bestowed from above. It has to expand democracy, not diminish it. She wrote that the negative, the tearing down, can be decreed. The positive, the building up, cannot. That was new territory, and only experience would be capable of correcting and opening new ways. Socialist democracy should not eliminate democracy because that is worse than the disease it is supposed to cure. For it stops up the very living source from which alone can come correction of all the innate shortcomings of social institutions. That source is active, untrammeled, energetic political life of the broadest masses of the people. It is well known and indisputable fact that without a free and untrammeled press, without the unlimited right of association and assemblage, the rule of the broad masses of the people is entirely unthinkable. Yes, I hope that that Felicity and other participants can comment on that and also make other points on it. As I already said, it was quite complicated to concentrate on the points because as I read, it was 30 years ago that I read the last time Rosa Luxemburg, I must commit. And now I read all the texts with new eyes, and so there was so much things which you can see in her writings. So that's it's really complicated to say what is essential to introduce here and whatnot. But I think the discussion will heal these problems.
Yes, Thomas, thank you so much. I think you did a brilliant job actually in summing up all the aspects of what is a very rich and a very full life, even the short time span of Rosa Luxemburg's life. She accomplished so much in practice and in theory, and I think you did a brilliant job of summing it up and of putting the record straight about what Rosa Luxemburg really stood for, because there is so much distortion and myth-making about that. I'm now asking Felicity to come in now without any delay, please. Felicity, you're welcome. The floor is yours.
As with Thomas, I kept being distracted preparing for this by rereading Rosa Luxemburg. She's very easy to read, very clear and precise in the way she writes. So you think she's going to read a few sentences and end up reading chapter after chapter. And I am no academic. I am not an academic scholar of Rosa Luxemburg. She's someone that we look to inform our practice rather than being academic. And there's much, much more, as Thomas has indicated, than I've put in this presentation. But here we go. So, I was thinking that Rosa would have been part of every caucus going. She's a woman of great courage, intellect and talent, a Jewess, subject to the anti-Semitism, the ruthless anti-Semitism of the time, a disabled person from birth, an immigrant. She was Polish, a socialist, a Marxist, a teacher, and a very good teacher, a writer. I think you can see she's a teacher in her writing. She's honed what she's saying in her lectures before she's actually written it down. She's an agitator, a theoretician, a revolutionary, profoundly a revolutionary. People try and sanitize her and make her into just some, you know, a nice poet, but she's not. She's a revolutionary, an anti-capitalist, an anti-imperialist, an internationalist, and an anti-war activist. She's a leader of the workers' movement. And in the course of the German Revolution, Rosa was murdered to help crush that revolution. Now, I'm going to skip the next couple of slides because Thomas has gone over these, but just they're basically there that she is born in Poland, moves to study in Zurich for her own safety, really, co-founds the Social Democracy of Poland, then moves to Berlin, gets involved in the internationalist movements of the time, the internationalist discussions. Quite outstandingly, she's involved directly in the 1905 revolution, which gave her a profound understanding of the importance of the mass strike. She spends time in prison. She attends the International Socialist Women's Congress in 1907. And I just want this slide, comrades, comes from Zero Calm, from the home-based women workers in Pakistan, in preparation for their sex celebration of International Women's Day tomorrow. They've constructed this collection of the early struggles of the women in Europe and in America. And when you see that, you know, Rosa comes from these struggles of the women that had been going on in her lifetime. And, you know, with Clara, this is her with Clara and Clara Zetkin, and the other one with her actually, and looks like she's on the back of a wagon talking to the demonstration, and a few of us have done that kind of thing as well. Brings her a bit closer to us. And then I think I'll skip a lot of this because Thomas has gone through all of that, but she's involved in the activity. It ended up where she was the person who opposed her and Clara were considered the last of the men in the Socialist International who actually opposed war. The final session of the International Socialist Bureau was held in Brussels, July the 29th, 1914, and resolved unanimously it should be the duty of the workers of all nations concerned not only to continue, but to further intensify their demonstrations against the war, for peace, and for the settlement of the Austro-Hungarian conflict by international arbitration. That was wiped away. A tiny handful stood firm on that issue. And when the First World War came to an end in November 1918, the German army had suffered 5 million casualties and 1.5 million dead. So she's released from the Breslau prison the day the Kaiser's abdication's announced and a new government is formed. She goes to Berlin, begins agitation, begins Die Rote Fahne. The fighting breaks out on the 24th of December between the government forces and the sailors. 31st of December, this is all within a week, she co-founds the German Communist Party with Karl Liebknecht, I'm not sure how you pronounce that name, and others in Berlin. Then there's the beginning of the Spartacus uprising, and then she's arrested by the government Freikorps, interrogated, taken to the Tiergarten, Liebknecht taken to the Tiergarten and shot. Luxemburg, headbutted, forced into a car, and then shot in the head and their body thrown in the canal. That film that Roger mentioned is very good in explaining how all of that worked. It's a very moving film. Sorry. So, at 9 o'clock on the 15th of January, Luxemburg and Liebknecht were arrested and taken to the hotel, the headquarters of the counter-revolutionary soldiers. At 10:45, Liebknecht's led out, abused, spat on, led downstairs to a side exit, placed in a car, struck twice on the head with the rifle, punched in the head, then driven to the lake. And then 11:40, Rosa Luxemburg led out through the angry crowd. On the way to the car, rifleman Runga struck her head with the rifle butt, knocked her unconscious. She stumbled and lost a shoe. She was struck on the head again, then thrown into the car. Her shoe was kept by the soldier as a trophy. And another soldier stole a letter that she had from Clara Zetkin from her handbag, which was later sold to a historian in 1969. About 40 meters from the hotel, a shot rang out. Sushan had placed the pistol to her left temple and fired, shattering her skull and dislocating her jaw. Vogel threw her body into the canal near the bridge. Her body was not discovered till the 31st of May. On the 12th of February, Leo Jogic published evidence from the Rota Fahna linking their murder to the army and the SPD. Leo was arrested in March 1919 and shot whilst escaping. The murder was shrouded in mystery for years, and then knowing he could no longer be prosecuted, the former captain Valdemar Pabst at a trial in Stuttgart in 1969 confessed he had ordered the murder following a telephone call to the SPD Defence Minister Noske. And here we have her murderers having a nice cup of tea together. These are the people who actually killed her. The hotel is the Eden Hotel. The man with the moustache is rifleman Otto Wilhelm Rung, a welder by trade. He was found guilty of smashing the skull of Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht with a rifle butt, and the only one committed to prison. The man behind him in a sailor's uniform was Edwin von Wazutski, an engineer fitter who leapt onto the vehicle to punch Luxemburg and Liebknecht in the car, making him a murder suspect. The two men seated below the waitress are riflemen Pop and Weber, who carried out the officer's orders to throw her into the canal. Businessman and chair of the Wilmersdorf Council, Fabian, paid the eight soldiers a massive 13,600 marks as reward. And now, really, why is Rosa still important? These are my opinions. A theory of the accumulation of capital is important to the whole concept of primitive accumulation and robbing the commons. The ideas of how capitalism is moving in this time of intense imperialism, how modern capitalism and globalization works, and the huge importance of the mass strike. And we have one of the pictures from India here showing us this movement that's still going through the Indian population at this moment. And of course, her position of wanting the end of capitalism, not wanting reform, but wanting the end of capitalism. And that's important in discussions with many different people, and especially with the young people getting involved on the climate issues, how capitalism cannot solve these problems. And how, you know, the imperialist class will move heaven and hell against the proletariat. It will turn the country into a smoking heap of rubble rather than give up wage slavery of its own free will. And of course, the ideas that are coming to the fore now, the importance of social reproduction, of the role of women and the community, not just of employees, of the huge concentrations of wealth that are going on at the moment, of the expropriation of people's wealth and their communities and their land and what goes on underneath their land. All of these things are intense areas of struggle across the world. The rise of the women's struggles, where women are a huge part of the proletariat, but also are involved in the actual social reproduction of society, with which there is no future, without which there is no future, on the role of nature, on how we have to work with nature and not against nature, not expropriating nature, on the appeal to the youth, on how young women especially look to Rosa Luxemburg as an icon, and how she is free of the taint of Stalinism. However much, you know, the Stalinists tried to kind of change her message, change her ideas, she's not seen to be part of that. And in the work that comrades are doing in Eastern Europe, that's particularly important. Rosa's ideas, of course, speak to women today. You've seen the what's going on in India, and this on the right hand side, the second one is a huge demonstration in Italy. This we have demonstrations in Britain, we have demos, but not at the moment because of the coronavirus, but huge movements of the class, of the women of the working class. And the growth of the global working class and their role in the future. Internationalism is natural in the working class. It's been with us for more than 150 years, but it has to be renewed again and again. And nationalism is often drawn in to break internationalism. Now, in terms of the climate catastrophe of socialism or barbarism, she wrote, "Violated, dishonored, wading in blood, dripping in filth, there stands bourgeois society. This is it. Not all spick and span and moral with pretense to culture, philosophy, ethics, order, peace, and the rule of law. But the ravening beast, the witch's Sabbath of anarchy, a plague to culture and humanity. Thus it reveals itself in its true and naked place." And I think John Ryman will recognize the picture on the bottom right. I think it's one I stole from him, certainly on the issue of the wildfires in California. But the whole planet, you know, we have a short time to win this battle if we're going to have a planet that remains, you know, capable of sustaining large-scale human life. And this, we have Rosa's grave. I was lucky enough, I think it was 1917, to attend the celebrations or the commemorations of her death. I sat in a cafe, this photo is taken from a cafe where I was sitting with a Spanish comrade, and we were both open-mouthed at the size of the demonstration and how you would have a Turkish contingent, a Polish contingent, every nationality coming through, organised on this demonstration. And then when you got off the train, it's a bit like going to a Liverpool football match. There were people there selling you all the stuff you need for the demonstration. And everybody bought an individual flower. So by the end of the demonstration, everyone's flowers were on Rosa's grave and the other graves in that cemetery, which is those who died in the fight for socialism. Right, Brecht wrote this song from his blog, and it's from up at the blog. He didn't write it in his blog. The link is there if anyone wants to find it. So he wrote it saying, "We've really got to give Rosa a helping hand." See, can I make it play?
Auf, auf, zum Kampf, zum Kampf, zum Kampf sind wir geboren. Auf, auf, zum Kampf, zum Kampf sind wir bereit. Den Karl Liebknecht, dem haben wir's geschworen, der Rosa Luxemburg. Reichen wir die Hand, dem Karl Liebknecht, dem haben wir's geschworen, der Rosa Luxemburg, reichen wir die Hand. Es steht ein Mann, so fest wie eine Eiche. Gewiss, gewiss, schon manche. manchen Sturm erlebt. Vielleicht ist er schon morgen eine Leiche, wie es so vielen Freiheitskämpfern geht. Vielleicht ist er schon morgen eine Leiche, wie es so vielen Freiheitskämpfern geht. Wir fürchten nicht, ja nicht, den Donner der Kanonen. Wir fürchten nicht, ja nicht, die grüne Polizei, den Karl Liebknecht, den haben wir verloren. Die Rosa Luxemburg fiel durch Mörder. Den Karl Liebknecht, den haben wir verloren. Die Rosa Luxemburg fiel durch Mörderhand. Auf zum Kampf, zum Kampf sind wir geboren. Auf zum Kampf, zum Kampf. Zum Kampf sind wir bereit, den Karl Liebknecht, dem haben wir's geschworen, der Rosa Luxemburg reichen wir die Hand, dem Karl Liebknecht, dem haben wir's geschworen, der
It's a huge field of struggle, of study to study Rosa Luxemburg. But if people have not done it beforehand, then the issue, then this, the graphic novel by Kate Evans is brilliant. Not a word in that book is from anyone other than Rosa Luxemburg. And it's beautifully presented and very popular amongst the young people that we work with. So I'll leave it at that. And in hope we have a good discussion.
Okay. Well, another brilliant contribution, Felicity, and I think that was just superb. So, right. It's open to any comrades who want to speak. Cheryl.
Yeah, so thank you very much for those presentations. I've been reading a lot about this, about Rosa Luxemburg and also the Weimar Republic era for a while now, trying to make sense of it, in part because, well, for good reason, post January 6th, the United States, once again, many people are saying, are we entering an era here similar to the Weimar Republic? For many decades here in the States, the left and socialists have raised the specter of fascism and saying, pointing to the Weimar Republic in this era and mistakes that were made as a warning in some way. So in order to understand this, I went back, well, is that true? What are the parallels and what are the differences between what we're living through now and that period, which is a different topic? I had not read much of Rosa Luxemburg before. I certainly knew who she was. And I have read, not everything about her, but a fair amount, and reading a lot about this period. And I have some questions. I guess I find her writing, unfortunately, a little bit more difficult than Felicity said, that it was very clear. The German Revolution was one of the most devastating failures of revolutions in the last century. there's only been failed revolutions or distorted revolutions, unfortunately. We haven't had a success yet. But the German Revolution was a real key turning point because of the rise of Stalinism and the war and the Nazis and World War II, more so than many other revolutions. But so I guess the question I have for the comrades is, was there anything that they could have done differently? Was there anything that Rosa Luxemburg, as brilliant and courageous as she was and experienced as she was, and Karl Liebknecht, was there any turning points that they could have, that something could have changed? Was the failure of the German Revolution inevitable? I know that's a huge question, and maybe we can't have the answer to that, but because Rosa Luxemburg was such a key figure at that time, and we looked to her for understanding of how to lead a revolution and what to do and what not to do, because I haven't come up with succinct answers to that question of whether or not the German Revolution could have succeeded. Everything you know, I've been reading a book that Roger actually had recommended to John called Hammer or Anvil by a woman named Evelyn Anderson that was published in 1945. And she's actually very critical of the Spartacists and said that even though they were brilliant, they were dedicated, they were very courageous, they did not succeed in developing a large base amongst the SPD workers or in the working class in general. Now, whether the working class wasn't ready, I mean, we certainly don't have that. But, and you know, I missed part of Thomas's presentation, unfortunately, but he said at the December 18th through the 20th, All German Workers Council, that Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht were not allowed to speak. And I'm assuming that they were excluded because of Ebert and the role of the SPD. But there's a lot of murky details in that very chaotic period in between November 9th and the end of December of 1918 that I don't understand. To try to make my questions and my comments more succinct. So Rosa Luxemburg and her sort of the theory of spontaneity is a problem for me, because my view of history and of failed revolutions in history is that it was always a problem of leadership. Whether it was a leadership that simply was opposed to revolution in the case of the German SPD, they were opposed to revolution. They were clear, we don't want revolution. But those that wanted a revolution had, of course, a very difficult situation. What are we fighting for? Obviously, the Bolshevik Party knew that they wanted revolution, and Lenin and Trotsky and others understood that, and they were prepared to take power. But everything I've read was that there was either a hesitation to take power, or that there was a belief, philosophy, that the workers, this is my impression of Rosa Luxemburg, that you know, in her writing, she says that the workers themselves must take power. I'm unclear on what her understanding and what her view of actual leadership was. And I mean, and she was critical of the Bolshevik Party. And, you know, I'm good on her for raising those criticisms and debating about it. And perhaps she was right in some ways. But was there an element in that view that was also a shortcoming in that moment in Germany, because there needed to be a leadership of some kind? The Spartacist League was really the only group that understood clearly the revolution was needed and was dedicated to it, but yet they weren't successful. Was that a shortcoming on their part, or was it simply that the working class wasn't ready? Although it doesn't appear to be the case when you look at the mass strikes, the workers and soldiers councils, the mutinies. So I would like some of these, I'd be interested to know what the comrades think about this. And could something have been done differently at that time? Because we are desperate to understand how a revolution can actually be successful, and with international solidarity as well, because we know revolution cannot succeed in one country, because all we've had is failures. So that's it, thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Raised some very important questions there. Next is Aman from Iran.
Hi, thanks very much. First of all, I wanted to thank the speeches that were given. Well, I learned a few things on here, and I'm very glad for that. Just one thing which I thought probably would be useful for me to mention was to say that on the 8th of March, I just thought I'd give you a view of what's happening in Iran in terms of a quick report, just a very, very brief one. As you know, that it is not possible to actually hold demonstrations and marches. So a variety of celebrations and meeting took place rather more closed rather than open and public. We had a couple of important activities that was organized. One was in the Kurdistan, where a group of people actually gathered, and one of the women actually started and gave a history of the 8th of March. And at the end of it, they had a document that they read in terms of the rights of women and the lack of their rights and the requirements for equality in all aspects, social, economic, and political, and also against the current scenario and the pressure that is on women in Iran. There was also another one that came up with the workers in the south on the Haftapper, where they actually had another action, and they started to say or raise their notes with regard to the celebrations of 8th of March, and congratulations to everybody on the commemoration of this day, and that they had a slogan that was specifically said that this is the day of the sound, or if you like, the screams of people in Iran against the inequality and for the rights of women as part of, or the larger proportion of the population, and that their right is effectively can only be done through socialism, which was, I think, another good one. I just saw that pass those, and well, congratulate everybody and commemorate the 8th of March. Thank you.
Thank you, Oman. Very good. Now, Comrade Silvana from Brazil.
Good afternoon, everyone. I think the revolution that we are waiting for is possible. I think without fight, like Rosa Luxemburg had to deal with it. I think once we are in power, we can change the rules. But I believe we need to help the third world to be independent, because without their independence, it would be hard. Because each time the third world tries to make it better, the first world countries come and try to take what they have, either is the petroleum or the gold that's under the earth, the dirt. They want our water. How the socialism would be possible if the rich countries needs our products and our workforce? Because people in rich countries, they need to have cheap products for their families, for their people. I understand that. But how to maybe change the way people think about possessions, about having stuff that will make them happy? Because if you continue to make advertisements saying that you're going to be happy just by having stuff, I think socialism is going to be hard. I think we need to be able to live what we have, maybe be more content what we have. Because in the third world, people live with nothing. They don't have food. But guess what? In Brazil, we are the first country that sells like agricultural products, but our families, our comrades, they don't have food to eat today. Children are dying for food in there, in Africa, and all the other countries. So maybe we think we need to change our thinking here also. How can we do revolution if we thinking about having like powerful cars, beautiful watches, modern things. I don't know, maybe we need to go back a little bit. I don't know. Because sometimes you think that you're gonna be very happy having like a bunch of stuff that you don't even use them. So maybe the revolution is to start right there. Thank you, comrades.
Okay, thank you. Now Ed is next, and then Trish, then Thamos. Anybody else, please raise your hand on the participants list. Ed.
Yeah. Thank you, Roger. Well, I completely agree with what Silvana has just said, that with a socialist revolution, humanity will develop different priorities, and what constitutes economic progress will no longer be a whole series of frantic consumer booms with people piling into retail and getting more and more goods that can be thrown away and things. The criteria for the economic success of humanity will be things like, are health services available to every population on the planet? Is every child on the planet getting enough to eat? Are there decent houses to live in for everybody on the planet? And that will be possible when the resources of the planet are under the rational control, a planning system based on human intelligence, rather than the laws of the market, which are always orientated towards profit, particularly profit of big companies, rather than the priorities of human well-being. So I agree with that. I want to comment also on Cheryl's contribution, which I think did raise a lot of really interesting and important points. I'm only referring to the CWI, the Committee for a Workers' International, here, because sometimes by looking at the mistakes of people who are striving for socialism, we can work out perhaps a more precise way of developing the kind of revolution we need. When I was in the CWI many years ago, we would discuss revolutionary possibilities here, revolutionary possibilities there, Spain, India, wherever. And the conclusion was always, if only we had some comrades there, then things would be different. And I can understand that approach, because there's no doubt, and Cheryl's correct in my view, that revolution does require leadership. And leadership needs to be organized and have studied theory and be planned in advance. But the question, in a way, Cheryl was asking is, what is the relationship between spontaneity and leadership? What's the relationship between the pre-existence of forces who've anticipated revolutionary possibilities from a generation back, perhaps, and a movement that comes from a groundswell of the masses who maybe, as we can see all over the world today. I mean, I just had a message from Senegal this morning that there is a revolution breaking out in Senegal. Practically everywhere we look, there are revolutions breaking out. And I don't agree with Cheryl, however, that all we have had is failures. I think there is progress that can be seen in the history of revolution and counter-revolution in Europe throughout the 20th century and into this century. I mean, for a start, the Russian Revolution was an enormous success. It led to a country that was at the level, of primitive agriculture, of very impoverished peasant communities and so on, being lifted to the second mightiest economy in the world that sent rockets into space in the 1960s and 1970s. It was tremendous progress. It's not correct that all we have is failures. Could something have been done differently? Yes. I mean, some of the byproducts of the Russian Revolution even, for example, the Labour government in Britain in 1945, and the fact that it went so far with the introduction of the welfare state and a national health service and so on, was a byproduct of the revolution, because the ruling class in Britain feared so much the threat of revolution that they knew that they would have to have some kind of fundamental reforms. Things like the independence of Poland at the end of the First World War was a byproduct of the Russian Revolution, because nobody was taking any notice of the demands of national minorities in the great Russian Empire for independence until there was a revolution. And then suddenly they realized that if we don't do something about this, then more and more nations or semi-nations who are going to be clamoring for Bolshevik leadership. So if you look at the strategy, the tactics, the understanding that workers in Europe had of revolution after the revolution, things like the struggles in Spain in the 1930s, the workers' grasp of what is necessary is far more mature than it was prior to the Russian Revolution. And and we witness this today as well. I mean, you know, I remember hearing recently in this forum in Wien, you know, comrades commenting on the different revolutionary movements that we've had over the last 10 years or so since the beginning of the Arab Spring, that there's, with each wave of revolution, there is a growing maturity. Now, that connects with this thing of how we develop a leadership. Leadership doesn't come, as the CWI imagine, just from having one or two comrades who've got all the right ideas. Leadership also comes from having a maturation of the masses as they experience different waves of struggle. And through that maturation, new ideas are developed, ideas that maybe even those who thought of themselves as leaders never anticipated in advance, because every revolution throws up new paradoxes, new initiatives from the masses that even the leaders don't think of. So, yes, Cheryl is right that we need to study these revolutions and ask what could have been done better. No doubt, and we have a lot to learn. But I think Cheryl is wrong if she's really trying to say that all we've had is failures. We've made enormous progress. And the witnesses today, look at the planet today, the level of maturity of people coming into action to try. I mean, they don't come into action now in name it, Algeria, Belarus, anybody. They don't come into action demanding they want a change of leader, a new president. They come into action demanding that the whole lot are kicked out. That is mature. That's huge. That is already the beginning of a revolutionary party. And we'll get there, Cheryl. I mean, we can't guarantee it. We can't guarantee it, but we don't have to go around thinking, if only we, I'm not saying you're saying this, but some people do in the CWR, if only we were there, you know, because the workers in these countries with the collaboration they get internationally, the workers will develop the means, the wherewithal, the structures, the parties that are required to take power.
Right, very good, Ed. Trish, you're next.
Well, that was fantastic. That was absolutely fantastic. You said a lot of what I think I wanted to say in many ways, Ed, but just to add to it, I know Cheryl's point and I understand it. What do we learn from the things that didn't work? And then coming through what Silvana said and then coming to Ed, I think there is a thread there in that I don't think revolution is about flipping something round. You know, we have to remember Rosa Luxemburg was making her massive waves at a time of women's suffrage, something that came out of the Russian Revolution, and eventually in Britain, the right for women to vote. That in itself was a revolution. And we have to remember that all the way through, that maturity that Ed talked about is very exciting. And I see Cuba as a success. I know that might not be how other people view it, but I think that was extraordinary success and continues to be a success against all odds, really. You know, Fidel's gone, and that I think is probably a tragedy, but of the future of it. But I think it's been an extraordinary success. And I think that, you know, different rights that have come forward throughout the process. And let's face it, you know, the French got rid of their royal family. So did the Russians. That's a success, as far as I'm concerned. If we're looking at what happened in the past, that we used to doff our cap to the our caps to the aristocracy, it still happens here, particularly in Britain. We still doff our cap very, very much. I mean, they've used that as a way of controlling British sort of uprisings all the time, because British people are culturally constantly forced in a way. The propaganda drips all the time, particularly about the war and poppies and Royal Britannia crap. There's a desperate need for us to love our Queen. But the fact is, we haven't got there yet, but we've had a couple of examples of where it's worked. And it doesn't mean, I don't think after revolution we get a perfection, and I don't think we can expect it, because culturally people aren't ready for a revolution. They're dragged toward it. Self-defense, usually something's happening that's frightening them, hunger or some sort of attack, and they'll join in the crowd in self-defense. Revolution, socialism is self-defense. People will run together, and when they get there, they don't necessarily know what to do, and they're not going to do it very well, and there's still going to be power struggles between men and women, as I'm sure that Rosa would have experienced all the time. She may have wanted social revolution. She realized when she got there, it was full of men who weren't listening to her, because she was a woman. At the time, she was probably really struggling to get her voice heard, and she was probably hating the arseholes she was having to deal with because they weren't listening to her. So I don't think revolution can be, we have it and then we all jog along. We have constant revolutions every day in our families, in our communities, and in our hearts and minds, really. And I think we've had lots of success. And hopefully now, following some real pep talk today from Roger, I feel that we might be on our way again. But I just wanted to say, I think we've had lots of success in following on what Ed said. And look at my last point is Greta Thunberg. She's creating a revolution of back to what Silvana said, how we live, what we need, what we spend, what we use, how we use it, what we think success means. We're starting to change now, all of us. All of us are starting to head towards veganism, head towards thinking about rewilding again, thinking about our environment in a way that says we're not going along with this flow anymore. The revolution is get rid of the royal family and get rid of the bloody farmers, the ones that produce meat. And this is happening, and we're going to do that. It's going to happen, maybe not in our lifetime, but our children's lifetime. I hope so. That was all I wanted to say.
Thank you, Trish. Another characteristically lively contribution. Next contribution is Themos, please, from Cyprus.
Well, this is turning out to be quite a night. First of all, we had two brilliant opening contributions, and had we stayed there, it would have been a brilliant night. And then we had some points raised by Cheryl, which put some questions, and suddenly it turned the night into a brilliant discussion that is giving us all sorts of points and to think about and go further down. Now, could Rosa Luxemburg have done something different? Yes, of course. Everybody can do something different. And if we see what happened and that the German communists were decimated and the movement was left without leadership everything was confused, and social democracy continued its betrayal to the revolution. Yes, something went wrong, but what was that? And I think we should be careful when we are talking about doing something different, whether we're discussing it today and finding what we can do and what can be done, it's fine. When it's a counterfactual history, you should be very, very careful. Because where do we stop? I mean, if Rosa Luxemburg made a mistake, it doesn't mean that she didn't take the right decisions. was can we accuse Connolly for taking part in the Easter Rising? Even worse, can we accuse Lenin and Trotsky for taking power? I mean, yes, we may have some successes in Russia, brilliant successes, and we gained brilliant knowledge from the revolution. But then was Stalinism. Were they right? Were they wrong to take power? So all this, when we talk about revolution, we shouldn't only say judge the result, judge the correctness of the revolution from the result, because a result can only develop through the fight of thousands of cadres and millions of revolutionaries going into the fight. And we shouldn't either judge the possibilities of a revolution from a single country. I mean, if you take Germany alone and say, oh, well, German revolution was developing and we should develop our forces before going into the fight so that we don't get lost. That is fair. But if we are talking about the situation in 1918, we are talking about the Russian Revolution going forward. And the Russian Revolution was not the Russian Revolution. It was a world revolution. It was the beginning of the world revolution. That was very clear in the minds of the Marxists of the period. So what was Rosa's choice? What was the Spartacist's choice? Stay calm and wait a few years until they could do something in Germany. That would mean the death of the Russian Revolution. So at that time, a decision had to be taken. Do we go national or do we continue the internationalist line we are taking? And in this case, I think arguments can be built for both sides. What is important is to understand the dilemmas that we are facing. Rosa and Liebknecht took the decision to go forward. And they knew that their chances, they probably knew that their chances were not great. But it was their bid to strengthen the world revolution, to find, to light another fire for the revolution, and they took their chance. This could be done in many countries at the time. Some tried it, some they failed, and Russia was isolated in them. This doesn't mean that they were wrong. It means that we have to judge every situation on its merits, take into account all the possibilities, see how we can go forward and go. Now, whether we succeed or not, it will depend on a millions of factors. And depending on the general situation, it could be right or wrong. So I think we should discuss it, and it's a good that we're discussing it. We should not be blind to the destruction that was caused by this rising. But that's what I chose to follow, to take the revolution to victory. And Rosa's greatness in her last act was this, I think, that he chose revolution. He didn't choose capitulation to capitalism.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, fellas. John was down to speak, but I see his hand is not up now. Are you there, John? John Ryden?
Yeah, I'm here. Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. So there's been a couple of important and interesting issues been raised in this discussion. And you know, there's that saying, a smart person learns from their mistakes, but a truly wise person learns from the mistakes of others. And of course, that's true from our from our successes, but it's also true from our mistakes. And in the first place, I think that Ed misunderstood what Cheryl was referring to when she said that there have not been successes. I think she was referring to the revolutions since the time of Rosa Luxemburg, which means since the time of the Russian Revolution. So we do have to look at what went wrong in all those succeeding revolutions and attempted revolutions. And the meaning of success is the overthrow of capitalism and the establishment of socialism, including a healthy democratic workers' state. And I think that Cheryl is right, that that has not happened since the time of the Russian Revolution. And I think that there were opportunities at some periods in some situations since then. And we do have to look at what went wrong and the differences in the views of Lenin and Luxembourg. And do those differences have any relevance to what went wrong in the succeeding revolutions and attempted revolutions? And you know, Ed quotes what the CWI position was, which I think, as he said, it was not exclusive to the CWI. And as he said, their position was, if only we had some comrades there, then things would be different. And I know that that was the CWI position, and it is still probably still their position, and it's still the position of all the myriad little revolutionary sects that exist today. But that's not the point. That's not what Cheryl is. That's not the attitude that Cheryl is raising. Because for one thing, how a revolutionary leadership developed in 1917 and in the period leading up to that is something entirely different from how a revolutionary leadership will and can develop in this period. But that question still does have to be considered. incidentally, what Ed said about the one justification, one success that he gave for the Russian Revolution was the independence of Poland, was a byproduct of that revolution. But on that, I mean, Rosa Luxemburg, for all of her heroism and for all the brilliance that she represented, she opposed the independence of Poland. And I think that Lenin was right on that, on the national question. And that most certainly today, that issue has come back to haunt us a million times over. And also Ed said that in each wave of revolution, there's a growing maturity. Well, that's true to an extent, but you also see tremendous setbacks in that maturity. It's not like the consciousness and the understanding of the working class just is moving forward in an never-ending march towards victory. I mean, just look, for instance, the last great revolutionary wave on this planet was the Arab Spring. And what's happened since then? That the Arab Spring was defeated, we have to say that. And the result of that has been the rise of reaction in that part of the world, in particular in the form of Islamic fundamentalism. So it's not like victory is inevitable. And the comment, also Ed commented that the workers will get the parties they need to take power. I don't think that that's necessarily the case. They may, but they may not. It's not something that will inevitably develop. And that gets back to some disagreements that we have within WIN. In particular, I remember I had a debate, this was quite a few years ago, with Ed and with Roger about what form a working class party would take in the United States. And my view is that it while it will be a huge step forward, and I've campaigned for that ceaselessly for years now, the development of a working class party, but I think it will not be a revolutionary party unless revolution has already succeeded throughout the world. I think it's almost inevitable that it will attempt to reform capitalism in its earliest stages. And so, and that was different from what Ed and Roger expressed. This was several years ago. So I do think that these, just finally, I do think that we need to discuss again, how do we see the outbreaks of anti-capitalist, what are in essence anti-capitalist protests throughout the world, including in the United States? And of course we see that as something positive. Of course we have to participate in it and applaud it and so on, but also do we or do we not take a somewhat independent position and explain what we think is the way forward also for those movements, yes, in a sympathetic and diplomatic way and all of that, but still, do we do that? Or do we just simply go with the flow? So I think that these are important issues that we do need to discuss.
Right, thank you, John. Next I've got Cheryl. Do you want to come back?
Yeah, John said a fair amount of what I was going to say. I mean, I guess the comrades don't know me that well, but of course I would never say that the Russian Revolution was a waste of time or defeat, and I wouldn't say that about Cuba either for that matter. But yeah, so I wasn't trying to say that. What I was trying to say is that in my lifetime alone, in our collective lifetimes, we have seen many attempted overthrows of capitalism that have not succeeded, and the results have been absolutely devastating. You can go from Iran to Chile. I mean, there's just a long list. And this is very disturbing to me at age 66 years old, having dedicated a great deal of my life to trying to end this fucking system of capitalism. So that's one thing. And I would like comrades to give some more examples of what they say is the maturation of the masses as they come into struggle against this system. I'm not saying they don't happen, but what I'm seeing here in the States, for example, so yesterday I heard a podcast on the radio that was absolutely fascinating. It was about a group of young people, young African-Americans in New York City in the Bronx, who called themselves the Warriors. I had not heard this story before. It was an incredible story, and it was like a microcosm of the development of consciousness as people come into struggle. And it sort of focused on, so they came into struggle under Black Lives Matter after the murder of George Floyd. And it told the story of how each of them, one by one, and I see Pam's note, yes, this is what the youth, this is a story about the youth, about Black youth in the United States. And one of them decided to run for office. And so he began to pull away from some of the more militant protests and how they were organized, because he didn't want to look bad. He wanted to make sure that he impressed the politicians. So that's a classic course of action. Let's withdraw from more militant and confrontational activities and to expand our struggle to other workers. So that was his role. Another young man was almost killed by the police, or by what he thought was an undercover cop. That's another question about the role of the state and the understanding of that, the surveillance state. And he became much more militant and felt that the sort of, they called it Black Joy activities, where the demonstrations were just sort of dancing and we're gonna show people we're just joyous in our everyday activities. It was another way of demonstrating, but it wasn't a confrontation of power. And he became disillusioned in that. And he said, he was really drawn, he understood innately that this was about power. And who has the power? Who has the power to direct the police? Who has the power to control whether we live or die? So he was drawn into a more militant direction, which drew him to the shutting down of one of the most important bridges. That's a revenue source for New York City. And so, you know, the report is there at this demonstration where people almost are intoxicated by the challenge, by the sense of, this is what it could be like if we were actually taking power. But that's where it ends, because they don't have a program to take power. They don't have demands to take power, and they don't know what to do. And so this young man becomes alienated. I'm saying this is the process that we've seen repeated in a microcosm over and over and over again. So I don't know about this question of them, just this sort of spontaneous maturation of the masses, and they'll come to revolutionary conclusions. So if you, so you couple that, I mean, so in this country, I mean, the consciousness of the working class, and I would say as well as in the UK with Brexit and with the rise of Trump and white wing extremism, there's been a throw, the consciousness of the working class in this country has gone way back. We've had lots of discussions about this, the loss of the militant traditions, fighting traditions, class consciousness. And whether maybe that will be overcome very quickly, I don't know. But it's a fact that we are all dealing with. And the, you know, it's a very demoralizing fact. So I had one last point. There is a terrible vacuum of leadership. And again, we continue to advocate in whatever small arenas we can for breaking away from the Democrats and fighting for a working class party, because it would be one small but very important step in that direction. So any case, this is obviously discussion that needs to, oh, I'm sorry, my last point. The insidious nature of the state and how I think that the average worker has no idea of the deadly nature of the capitalist state and the links that will go to, it will murder people, but it will also confuse people. This film that recently came out about the murdering of Fred Hampton, that is a very serious issue that we cannot overlook, because no revolution can succeed unless it has some understanding of the nature of the state and how to defeat its efforts. So thank you.
All right, thank you, Cheryl. Made for a very interesting and lively discussion so far. Next I've got, it's either Dominic or John Byrne. What, I don't know which of you wants to speak.
Muted.
Yeah, I know.
Yes, the point I want to make, and I think it's coming through, is our job is to win the working class, and particularly the organised working class, to the banner of socialism. And I think we have to realise that we're up against some very serious adversaries. In particular, and it comes back to Rosa Luxemburg, the adversaries are the right-wing leadership of social democracy. We've seen it in Britain with the absolute hatred of Jeremy Corbyn. And at the end of the day, Jeremy Corbyn was advocating a reformist programme and not, if you like, mass nationalisation. He wasn't advocating a fully blown socialist programme, but, if you like, taking up issues of reformism. And I think our job as the organisation to build a Workers' International is in our various countries and internationally to win the working class and particularly the leadership of the more militant elements of the working class to the need for socialism. That, you know, we can quote like Trotsky, or I think it was Trotsky, he wrote, who said that we face either socialism or barbarism. And we can see that in many ways. In Britain at the moment, the government is cutting its aid budget to the most needy elements in the world. The Chancellor of the Exchequer is talking of cutting £20 off the wages of some of the poorest people in Britain. And this is reflected internationally. And that's the point I want to make, is we've got to be patient. We've not got to go over the top in attacking the right wing, but in showing them, showing the workers that the right wing are bankrupt. They support capitalism and they oppose any meaningful reforms. We want to see reforms in the health service, in education, in housing. But to do that, we would be challenging capitalism itself. So that is the point I just wanted to make.
All right. Thank you. Just to point out, by the way, that quote, socialism or barbarism, was actually Rosa Luxemburg's.
Oh, well.
So very appropriate for this discussion. I've got two more people down at the moment. That's David and Dave. So, David, first, please.
Well, like others, you know, I think it's a
and been a very rewarding discussion, and we had some excellent lead-offs, thanks to the comrades. Let me start with three points. I want to deal with, first of all, with the aftermath of struggle. And let me give you some examples of where national liberation movements have come to power with the support of working people to carry out a revolution, and has actually ended up in a situation of counter-revolution. I just want to touch, we shouldn't underestimate the dynamics, you know, of counter-revolution, particularly in third world countries. Let me just give the example of Angola, Mozambique, and South Africa, and Zimbabwe too. In each of these countries, you know, working people, and particularly the peasants in some of these countries, you know, gave their sons, gave everything to the liberation struggle. And we brought to power people who modeled themselves on maybe on Castro, or possibly on the Stalinist leadership of Eastern Europe and Russia, and came to power. And within 10 years, they had the complete control of the state and of all the commanding heights, the rest of it in their hands. And within 20 years after being in power, you found a bureaucracy which was completely kleptomaniacally involved in stealing every single thing possible from the people, from the state, and from every other institution which had wealth. From the IMF, they even managed to steal, I think it was 7 billion, the Mozambican bureaucracy managed to steal $7 billion from the IMF. and IMF still trying to get that money back. Amazing stuff that's going on. And none of this is in the bourgeois press, or very little is in the bourgeois press. It's only now being, you know, found. Now, why am I making this point? In other words, we have seen the complete degeneration of revolutions in these countries. In South Africa, the MK, Inkatha Kwesizwe, the people who struggled for power and were going to completely change society, are now marching in the streets of South Africa with anti-Black slogans, demanding the complete loss of housing, any jobs, and so forth to people who are regarded as foreign Blacks, Black people living in South Africa who did not have South African citizenship. They're actually worse than the white racists, because the white racists wouldn't be able to do that. But they're marching in the streets of Durban and elsewhere, demanding that this happen. And more than that, they're going around and burning the streets and assaulting the women and killing people without any redress from the police. Now that shows something what's happening after an attempted revolution and how counter-revolution develops. And we have to have our eyes wide open to these prospects. And the same in Venezuela. Half the hospitals in Venezuela don't even have running water. There's very low COVID figures in Venezuela because there's no petrol, no one's traveling anywhere. So COVID has been reduced. But this is we are really in a state of barbarism. I mean, we have to call it by the facts. I mean, it's not whether we can still have reform or barbarism, you know, revolution or barbarism, we are already in the states of barbarism. We have to face these facts. Now, how do we retrieve this? This is where we have to, you know, to have our eyes wide open. With every revolution, there's counter-revolution. And this, the examples, the detail of the counter-revolution in the case of Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht is absolutely brutal. Let me give you an example in South Africa. We started the trade unions. We had my strikes in 1973. When I came out of the country in 1976, I was given a file to review. And that file was headed the financial support for the trade unions in South Africa. This was entirely to give $1 million to Gacha Buthelezi, a reactionary element, but it claimed to be, you know, in favor of change. And that was movement I fought to make sure that that money never got there. Eventually it did get there, and there was a slaughter of workers. Every revolution throws up counter-revolution, and imperialism is always eager, you know, to fund, you know, those who are prepared to come and kill. And I think one of the lessons, you know, certainly I've found reinforced from what I've heard today, is that we must not be naive. We have to be aware that every revolutionary upsurge, and we'll see it the same in Myanmar and the same in Egypt, where there had been a revolutionary movement, democratic movement, same in Algeria and Sudan, there are professional groups out to come and kill us. And we have to be aware of this, and we have to have self-defense. We have to think of self-defense. We must not be naive. And one of the last points I'd make is that in relation to the question of how do we defend ourselves, we have to maintain the maximum unity on the left. I think one of our comrades, was it Dominic or John, raised this point. We have to deal with the right wing very sensitively in the labor movement, mainly because we've got to be aware of trying to maintain maximum unity at all times, even if we know exactly what these people are wanting to do. We cannot spell it out. We have to know it ourselves, but actually express ourselves in a way which can try and maintain the unity of the working class against formidable enemies, which we are now going to spring up and come for us. You know, the tragedy, you know, that hit Rosa Luxemburg, I mean, I can't believe the comrades were not better secured. You know, that there wasn't more defense, you know, given to securing leading comrades at that time. We have to be aware of this. And I do think we need to give consideration, particularly at times of the revolutionary upsurge. At certain times, we're just boring to the ruling class because they think we're not up to anything. But other times, they're deadly interested in what every single move that we make. And we have to take that seriously. Thank you. Mm.
Thank you. And the last speaker is Dave.
Last speaker, no pressure then. okay, comrades, really, really fantastic lead-offs and a really interesting meeting, and the directions that people have taken the discussion have been interesting. I just want to touch on one thing, which is let's call it the controversy about the failure of revolutions. Sorry, I'm admitting someone to the meeting now. The failure of revolutions. Now, I would say that the very fact that the revolutions take place is a success. Now, many of them do fail, and I think this is a really, really important issue for revolutionaries. Why do most of the socialist revolutions fail? And if anything, we should pay more attention to those issues. So why did the German Revolution fail? I know that the first person who raised this sort of made some quick remarks and mentioned Stalinism. Well, Stalinism wasn't around when the German Revolution took place. And it's more to do with reformism in the guise of the Social Democrats, who were an absolute massive force, probably the biggest socialist force in the world at the time of the German Revolution. And they had, in terms of the way they were organized, their depth and breadth across the working class, sort of in the trade unions, in socialist clubs, you name it, gymnasiums. But they had a reformist position. And they also, when it came to it, although they said before the First World War they opposed the war, the SPD actually supported the war. And, you know, that this is why they were desperate to be shown as respectable that they could be part of a government, and they got to be in government, and they actually were, in terms of conspired against the revolutionaries and the communists to undermine them. So I think we ought to have a meeting on failed revolutions, or that period, indeed, the Russian Revolution, and why did the why did the Russian Revolution fail? And I mentioned that because I wanted to talk about the subject of the meeting, which is Rosa Luxemburg, because she did write about the Russian Revolution. And I hadn't read her pamphlet on that. And I started reading it in preparation for this meeting. And it's extremely interesting because she is really critical of the Bolsheviks on the national question. Now, someone else mentioned the national question in this meeting and praised the position of the Bolsheviks. And she was absolutely opposed to the Bolshevik position and says, in fact, that they opened the gates to reaction, to counter-revolution, where the Bolsheviks had this sort of unbending position that you had to support the nationalists. And unfortunately, I can see Roger shaking his head. So, that's all right. It's a little bit off-putting. But she says, from what my understanding of reading this pamphlet, that was the incorrect position. Now, I think we could do the best credit we could do to the memory of Rosa Luxemburg is that when we have a meeting, is that we should now and again choose some key texts. And I think if the Workers International Network is true to its beliefs that there is no revolutionary one-line party fits all, and if only we build on the right lines with the right policies, then we can be the leadership of the revolution, then it should absolutely read critical thinkers who are on the left, who are revolutionaries like Rosa Luxemburg, and read pamphlets in preparation for a meeting on the subject of failed revolutions, for example, and then say, well, where was she right or was she wrong? You know, do we always slavishly follow the line of the Bolsheviks, or does history now, after 100 years and more, tell us that, in fact, maybe that's not the right position to adopt? And so I think we need to be reading more if this organization is to really deepen itself in terms of its understanding of socialist and revolutionary ideas. Now, I say that as someone who has not a great reader. Over my many years, I've lost many opportunities. I'm in my 60s now, and now I start reading, but I don't really read a lot. But if we were to urge people to read key texts around when we organize these meetings, I think these discussions would be even better than they are. And I do agree that certainly the translation I've read on via Wikipedia, that she is relatively easy to read compared to someone like Trotsky, who I find extremely difficult to read because he's forever using these sort of long-winded arguments to attack the right wing, which I find difficult to penetrate. But I'm just making a general comment that I think we should definitely honor the memory of Rosa Luxemburg by reading some of her, urging people to read her material and raise it and have that as part of a meeting. And I want to end on a quote from Rosa Luxemburg, because again, criticizing the Bolsheviks, not from a reformist position, but an absolute revolutionary, she said, "Freedom only for the supporters of government, only for members of one party, however numerous they may be, is no freedom at all. Freedom is always and exclusively freedom for the one who wants to think differently." And I think that I think we are such a group that we do want to think differently. And I think we need to read more of Rosa Luxemburg, and we'll be the better for it. Thanks, comrades.
Well, thank you very much. I think that was a very good way to end. I do want to make a couple of points in closing. But first, do Felicity or Thomas want to come back briefly?
Yes, please.
Yes, carry on.
In a really good discussion, and I definitely agree with what the last speaker said about it would be useful to, you know, have a discussion around a particular text. But I want to look at the issue that Silvana raised about the Third World and the, you know, the global south and the poverty in the global south, and how Rosa Luxemburg's work refers to that. Because of her work on the nature of capitalism and how capitalism has to continually find more places to expropriate, to steal from, I think that part is really important. Now, Elon Musk said famously last year that they would coup where they wanted to coup. We have a tiny handful of people who own the wealth of this planet. Literally, you know, Oxfam said it was a golf cart load of people who actually own and control the wealth of this planet. And they do as they please. But that concentration of the ownership of the means of production means that those people cannot get deep into the society. They cannot reflect the needs and the urges of society, and they cannot live without the society. You know, this concentration of wealth is actually has its own, you know, inherent contradictions in it. Now, within what we take as a movement from the struggles of Latin America in the 80s and the 90s and the early part of this century is that those struggles went deep into society, and that for all there were defeats and successes, that the concepts, some of the concepts that were developed there are very important to our agitational work. The sort of twin slogan of "we need a better world," and then that a better world is possible, are the beginnings of raising the ideas of socialism. Can be used in the street, can be used any basic ideas. And we owe that to the struggle of Latin America, and much more to the struggle of Latin America. But the total poverty seeing in society, this fact that this world can't feed all of the population that's living there, can provide a decent living standard for all of the population, and what stands between it is this ownership of the means of production, that we have to democratize the ownership of the economy. And I think that, you know, our nationalism has got to be complex and specific. We've got to look at the needs of the different spheres in our discussions and be very clear about it. Poverty, many people within our
Felicity, we're losing you.
Luxemburg wrote about when people move into action, not because they've read anything, but because it's really important. And that's what we're seeing in India. I don't know if comrades saw what the French comrades circulated this morning about the description of what's going on in India. But what's going on in India is a classic of the mass strike. And it wouldn't matter how how dedicated we are. We cannot change the world without the class coming into action. And that class action is across the world. And there's a process going on. Now, yeah, we can lose, be defeated again, as David so, you know, clearly. I'll finish on the fact that, you know, we need to pick up the different issues as well, but that's my final bit.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Felicity. Thomas, do you want a last word? Please keep it brief.
Yes. Yes, I think it was a brilliant discussion, and thanks to Gerald for the questions, which triggered the whole lively discussion. And I think it's absolutely right to have this question, because Rosa Luxemburg did everything to prepare herself on this situation. She had the perspective that such a revolution will come, and she prepared for it, and she was prepared. And in one sense, she made nothing wrong in the period after her release from Breslau. if you read the documents and the pamphlets in November and December 1919, I would say she made everything correct, and in the end she was dead and the socialist revolution defeated. So what went wrong? That's a correct question, I think, and which mistakes did they make? And we should discuss that, and we should discuss it from the point of view of today. I think it's not very fruitful to discuss it from, in one sense, in a historical sense, although that is also interesting. But it's not the question of whether Lenin and Trotsky were 100% right or Rosa Luxemburg were 100% right. I think that is a complete false conception of this debate, and it was historically not correct, and it's today even less correct to put it in that way. And Dave is absolutely right to read these books and pamphlets of Rosa Luxemburg, because in my experience, when I intervened in the revolution in the GDR in 89, from Rosa Luxemburg was absolutely crucial. I mean, the people, it was a tradition. Rosa Luxemburg was a tradition, you know, and if you talk with the people on the streets, and there were, you know, that 1 million on one day on 4th of November, 89 on the streets, and you could discuss with them, and not only with singles or with some people, but with many people about Rosa Luxemburg and her tradition and her position that there can't be a democracy without socialism, and there cannot be socialism without democracy. And it was a high level of discussion, if you like. And without this history, and without the person Rosa Luxemburg, such discussions were not possible. And so in the end, it's a complicated question. Yes, it was a defeat. Yes, it led to the Nazi Germany in the end, this defeat. And on the other hand, she, with her perspectives, if she would have not been killed, and that was a mistake, and David Hampson is absolutely right. In general, she saw the dangers of reaction, but in concrete, she didn't see it, and she refused to leave Berlin. And imagine what could be happened if Rosa Luxemburg was not killed in that situation, because it was not only the revolution in 1918, but it was the whole period from 1918 to 23, which was in turmoil, and it was a lively process of revolution and counter-revolution. And if she would have been able to intervene in such a situation with her background and with her standing and with her authority also in the international discussions, could change history, if you like. I mean, I don't want to overestimate the role of single persons, but on the other hand, you know, she was an exceptional person. And so therefore, we shouldn't underestimate reaction. The murders were paid by the Deutsche Bank and with the anti-Bolshevist fund, funded by paid by the Deutsche Bank and other companies at that time. And so we should be careful on the one hand. On the other hand, we should prepare for great events and be prepared like Rosa Luxemburg, and not to be unprepared like many others in the KPD in that time. I think that is, I think that could be a line which Wynne can follow, maybe.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Thomas. If you give me just a couple of minutes, one or two points I'd like to make. First of all, just to reassure Dave, when I was shaking my head, It wasn't on the issue that he raised about whether or not the Rosa Luxemburg criticism was correct, but it was the use of the word flexibility and inflexible. I think in that case, it was the Bolsheviks who were being flexible by making the concession towards nationalism and the right of nations to self-determination. And I think on this particular issue, Rosa Luxemburg was a little inflexible and brittle in the way she posed it. I'm not trying to say on this occasion who was right and who was wrong, but I just wanted to clarify what my the reading for my reaction. I want to say one thing about the success of this meeting, that one of the participants who you would not have seen, but one of the participants in this meeting was my great niece. When I say great, I mean that in both senses of the word. She's 10 years old. Her name is Rosa, and her name is not accidental. She was named in honor of comrade Rosa Luxemburg. So that was a great, in itself, that's a great achievement, I think, of this meeting. On the question that Peter Sinclair raised in the chat, yes, I can confirm our next meeting will be precisely on that question of perspectives for the USA with the transition from Trump to Biden, what it will mean and what lies ahead. We'll have comrade John will be speaking along with comrade Tia from Louisville. That's next week. I just wanted to say finally, I think that Rosa Luxemburg would have greatly approved of this discussion. She would have approved the thoughtfulness, the democratic debate. She would have approved of the gender balance also. She would have approved also of the internationalism of the debate. We had comrades from Germany, Britain, the USA, Iran, Brazil, and Cyprus participating. I think in every way, and particularly the democratic nature, as I say, of the discussion. And I do want to end by saying that it was entirely in the traditions of the quotation that I read from Rosa Luxemburg at the beginning, when she said that that we don't have the outlook that that we are the experts and that we need loyal followers of the true faith, that we don't have, as I said, popes or gurus in our political group. And I would like to end again with that last sentence that Luxemburg said. She said that Marxism's living force is best preserved in the intellectual clash of self-criticism and in the midst of history's thunder and lightning. There is plenty of thunder and lightning in the world today, wherever we look. And we proceed on the basis of criticism, self-criticism, honest, democratic debate, and that will be the strength of our work now and in the future.